everyone. We are back with more virtual interviews. I'm really excited to have Melissa with me. Melissa, I'm excited you're here.
I'm excited to be here, as always.
It's always fun to chat. And the good news is you guys see this part of the chats. Lots of us have lots of other conversations outside and get the opportunity to see each other.
Right.
So, like I said, it's always good to catch up. So, what's new in your world?
So, I took on a new role within Rainforest. I joined Rainforest QA about 9 months ago.
Right.
Was previously their consultant manager, and then in the last month, I took on a new role as their senior QA strategist. So it's really exciting to be in that role.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm helping with some thought leadership, really kind of making sure that the brand is awareness, getting out there, speaking on behalf of Rainforest, but really kind of helping them strategize and modernization of QA and QE, which of course you know is kind of some of the platforms and themes that I've been speaking and writing about. So it's been a really, really fun ride so far.
Huge deal, right? I mean, very big right now. So. You know, I think that's just such a great role because, I mean, especially to have the opportunity to do that. So for you, in terms of kind of things you see upcoming, you guys work with lots of clients, lots of people, and get lots of insight into big challenges. Did you go to the keynote this morning?
I sure did.
Yes. How does that play in with what you're hearing in the market space with your folks and kind of where they're at and what they're talking about?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, absolutely. It's definitely at the forefront of our customers and clients for sure.
Yeah.
But you know, what I think is really interesting is that even some of those challenges that have been within the industry and that have been challenging for companies, whether they're startups or even enterprise-wide, I still think that there's still a lot of challenges to solve still around efficient testing, the modernization, kind of dispelling the myths around what the perception of quality assurance and testing is and really what it should be. So although, you know, AI and all the machine learning and all that is still absolutely prevalent, there are, in my opinion, some things that we even need to fix before that in order for us to kind of lay the tracks and really offer that kind of innovative testing support within the, you know, within the industry.
Yeah, no, I mean, so interesting you say that because right before this, the folks virtually didn't get to see it, but there was a panel with four folks on it, Jason Arbon, who did one of the keynotes, Jeremy, who is from Retest, he owns that company, which does the web AI. Then you had Tariq from Ultimate Software, where they do it internally for Ultimate. Mm-hmm. And then you had Jeff Meyer from Dell, who does it internally for Dell.
Right.
And Jeff, who is one of the, and you know, is a company doing it, said exactly what you just said of there's some foundational elements that need to be in place, right? This
Absolutely.
Isn't like everyone's ready, drop it in. It's not unlike anything else we do, right? Automation, anything, when we start these new things, you can't just plop it in and hope it all goes.
Exactly, right. And I think there's something definitely to be said about the foundation, right? I think some of the, you know, the tools, tricks, whatever of the trade that we can do, but I found a lot of value in resetting. Part of the reason why I've been such a proponent of the modernization of QA, of course, but more interestingly, the quality engineering role and kind of what that, you know, other people in the industry have defined that. But I think that is really the shift and kind of allows us the opportunity to reset some of those things that we haven't quite been able to really solve well. And so by kind of disrupting and introducing that quality engineering characteristic, it allows us to address the things that have been pervasive, perhaps giving us the challenges, allow us the opportunity to hit the reset button a little bit, make sure that we're highly communicating, importantly, what quality engineering and quality assurance is, but even more importantly, what it's not. And so when you have somebody that has a perception of what testing or QA or QE has been in their experience without being able to provide them those resources to really give them the direction, that they're going to take that definition and run with it. And I think really that's where, in a lot of cases, we're seeing some of these pervasive challenges continue within the industry.
I would say too, the other thing I've been hearing is, you know, how do you shift the mindset? So exactly what you're talking about, right? Like foundational, but it's a mindset shift. And what do people do? I've heard a lot of leaders and managers asking the question of, I've got these people that just don't want to adapt. They don't want to do anything different. they don't want to change. You know, some of them don't want to change because they're like, can I just hang on for like another year and then I'm not doing this anymore. So why reinvent everything when I'm doing that?
Right.
And you may have a lot of organizations with lots of those people.
I think you're absolutely right. I've had many conversations over the last couple of days, whether speaker one-on-ones or after my sessions, where it's absolutely right.
Yeah.
First and foremost, QA professionals, whether you're a tester, quality assurance, quality engineering, regardless, if your main responsibility is interacting and testing the software, we are technologists, whether you like it or not, we are.
Right.
And the responsibility and onus on a technologist is to embrace tools and technology so that they can continuously improve and make those more repetitive tasks more streamlined and productive. So if we're not embracing and adopting tools and technology, I don't know how much you can fix that from the top, right? It really has to be an onus on that individual to take their professional development and career development into their own hands and really start embracing tools and technology like that.
Yeah, that's it. I know, it's such a challenge when you think about it, right? Like, they should own it. Why wouldn't you want to own it? But then you've got these people that just either over being worn out or burnout or whatever, maybe at a place where they don't want to, and it's almost like they lay on the railroad tracks and like you can't run them over, right? You want to like run them over, but what do I do with them?
It's interesting. That's such an apropos question at this point because we literally just had that in a discussion about an hour ago. You know, one thing where it's sometimes it's making sure that the introduction of a new thing, whether it's a process or a tool or whatever, is understood, and not just because I'm a head of a department or I'm the one that's mandating something or somebody else above me has mandated something. We have to be able to deliver that message, not just so that it's understood by me who's delivering it, but that it's also understood by everyone else. And kind of that sensitivity around what is the value? Why are we introducing test automation, for example, right?
Yep.
What is the value? And it's not simply it's going to replace you as a manual tester at all. And if that is ever the message, you know, that's a sure sign, you know, to get out of there or raise a flag at least. But the idea is, you know, the message may be very clear to me on why it's valuable and what it will eventually produce and have an outcome, but that it's really the onus is also on that department head or the person that's introducing that new process or thing to really make sure that the messaging is understood. And so that there's sensitivity around that. We introduce something like test automation so that you as the tester can spend more time on areas that you haven't previously been able to explore within the software. And that's the whole concept of introducing tools and technology. So I think a lot of it is in the messaging that's coming down and making sure that we're being sensitive with that messaging for our, you know, for the individual contributors and the team.
Yeah. Well, what do we think too? I mean, I've seen it not in a strange way, right? Sometimes what motivates us is almost like the gamification of things, where we see the reward and the benefit from doing it. And then we're like, oh, now I'll do a little more.
Yes.
Right, to encourage getting outside that comfort zone into the stretch zone of learning and, you know, getting new things. I don't know. I've been tossing around, does that help? Will that help people if you understand what motivates them and then giving them incentives that are aligned to what motivates them?
I think you're right. And for example, the situation that where we were chatting about, there was a fabulous training that was given to the testing team who was kind of moving into or expected to start getting familiar with test automation, for example. So the idea was that we're going to provide a training and we'll provide that training on a recurring basis until all of the training is provided. But the missing component was that simply attending the training wasn't enough, but it wasn't clear on what the expectations were. So what we had talked about, myself and the person that I was speaking with on this particular issue, was making sure that it's not enough to have that training. We have to then have homework outside of it.
Yeah.
And say, okay, so given this course, here are your three homework items between now and the following week. Yeah. And then that manager, in either recurring one-on-ones or whatever that is, we actually come back and check on that. So it was just kind of giving that extra level of accountability, incentivization, in some cases gamification, so that there was an equal responsibility and accountability on owning that. So,
I've been wondering, you know, how do you, because everyone likes something, right? Like, we all have a passion or something we like.
Yeah.
If we don't, then we have bigger problems. Right. But, like, there has to be something that they like where you go, okay, how can I help you? I get you may be burnt out or whatever the root cause is, but how do I help you get over that and get to a place of being excited again? Because if you are in that stage anyways, you know, you have to admit it's probably maybe not super fun to go to work every day anymore.
Yes, exactly.
Or you're not enjoying it, and you maybe are literally, they've probably got the calendar and they're like X-ing the days off. Like when you get there, you know you're in a bad spot.
Yeah. I mean, I think a good manager or good leader, you know, if those are one and the same in your company, sometimes it's not, sometimes it is. They should know how to adapt to their team members versus in some ways where we see that the manager expects the team to adapt to them, right? And so I've always taken, I felt very strongly that it's my responsibility as a manager, director, whatever my title is, to understand how to motivate and recognize the work that's being happened at the individual level versus having them adapt to me. And I think in that case, and you develop that relationship, you'll start understanding how to motivate them and say, you know, this person likes to be publicly recognized, but this person doesn't. And so when you start, again, fine-tuning that, I think you have a much broader and comprehensive and really trustworthy relationship that's built between them. Yeah. And then you can start incentivizing and really kind of tracking the things that are important, not only for the vision and strategy for the QA team or department, but also what's going to help drive that individual.
Absolutely. Now, for you, just in terms of in your strategist role, sounds so fabulous. So I'm sure you're doing all these fabulous things. What do you get to spend a lot of time just playing around, researching, looking at new things, experimenting? I don't know. It sounds like you should.
It is. So this is the first time that I'm ever reporting into a marketing team. And in my many years of my career, I'm not going to tell you exactly how long, but I've never actually worked with a marketing team.
Yeah.
And I personally am learning so much about the importance of marketing. So I'm getting exposure to a team or a department that I've never had previously a lot of exposure with.
Right.
So in addition to that, a lot of it is research and development. I'm understanding the trends of not only what's happening, but what's about to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's really where I'm going to be spending a lot of my time. And, you know, ideally kind of building content, whether I'm speaking about it or writing on it or doing a webinar on it, really kind of developing that. And all with the kind of understanding of that modernization, moving into that quality engineering mindset and developing it and adopting those characteristics around that.
Yeah. Wow. So cool. I love organizations and companies that have the foresight to see the value of that type of role. And there's not many. Your organization's one. There's one of the tool vendors that has something that I would call kind of a similar role for them. But it's brilliant, like, to have that. I mean, just the foresight and, you know that that's so critical.
Yeah, and of course, I've been very fortunate to have that role, right? And I take it very seriously. I mean, I really do think of it as a culmination of a long career in quality assurance and testing and quality engineering. And, you know, we don't want to, we never want people to reinvent the wheel if somebody's thought about it or if somebody's talking about it.
Yeah.
Again, that's why these conferences and other conferences like this and just the building of the community is so important so that we don't do that redundant, inefficient R&D when somebody may be doing it on their own and we can kind of collaboratively get that up, bubble it up in the community. And that's, you know, another very important component of the strategist role is to make sure that things that are happening in the community are being bubbled up, and yeah. we can kind of get that more information out back to the community.
Yeah, no, that absolutely makes sense. It always goes so fast when we chat because there's so many things to talk about. But if people want more information on that, we'd probably pique some people's interest being like, I need that role in my company. I want to be that. How can they contact you, find you, get a hold of you?
Anything under Melissa Tondi, LinkedIn, Twitter, melissa@rainforestqa.com is my email address. I'm always happy to chat. And I always love chatting with you on this topic.
Yay. Thanks, Melissa, for being here.
Absolutely.
We'll be back next with more interviews.